Why is there room for any number of angels on the tip of a needle? And why can't we put our head through the wall? After this introduction into Burkhard Heim's theory of the elementary particles, it will become clear to you. Hello and welcome to Six Dimensions in Color. My name is Hannes Schmid, and I explain to you Burkhard Heim's world in understandable language and with clear examples. As you may know by now, according to Burkhard Heim, we live in a six-dimensional world. Dimensions 1, 2, and 3 being ordinary space, he called the R3. Together with time, they form the R4, or four-dimensional space-time. The two additional coordinates are introduced in the last video, 5 and 6. He called the trans-realm of the world because they transcend ordinary space-time. And all six dimensions together, he called the R6, or simply the world, meaning the entirety of the world. And now the question is, what holds this world together at the innermost? In his theory, Heim proceeded from the assumption that space itself is quantized, that is, it consists of elementary geometrical elements which are not subdivisible. Similar notions have, of course, been put forward in quantum gravity and superstring theories, but Heim's elementary geometrical units can be deducted in a way that makes them appear as a true constant of nature. I will show that in another video. Heim found that these geometrical quanta are two-dimensional surfaces. Try to imagine the R3 as composed of a grid of such surfaces, like shown here, and then in the back of your mind, try to imagine there are three more axes. Heim called these elementary surfaces the metron, and their surface is 8.2 times 10 to the power of minus 70 square meters. Speaking of length or surfaces, of course, only makes sense for axes 1, 2, and 3, but by introducing calibration factors, you can extend this concept of surfaces to the other axes. That's nothing else than you do in Minkowski space when you multiply time by the speed of light. And similarly, it can be done for axes x5 and x6. If now anything happens at all, physically, then this grid of metrons deforms or twists. Heim speaks of a condensation of metrons because, projected into Euclidean space, they appear condensed. And Heim found out that this condensation can only take place in certain symmetrical groups of coordinates, these being space, time, and structure, these three. And depending on which dimensions partake, something different comes out in each case. I'm, of course, now only telling you the results. At this stage of the introduction of Heim theory, I can only ask you for your patience until I have treated the details in future videos. By the way, Heim called these different cases of geometrical deformations hermetry, which is a contraction of the words hermeneutics and geometry, meaning an interpretation of geometry. I will start with the most general case, D, and then go up to A, because A is the most interesting one, which leads to other questions. So starting with D means all six axes partake in this condensation of metrons. This results in the formation of charged, ponderable elementary particles, that is, particles with an electrical charge and a rest mass which can be weighed. Most prominent specimen being electrons and protons, of course. If time does not partake in this condensation, we have as a result neutrons, or generally neutral, not electrically charged, ponderable elementary particles. The next case would be that the spatial dimensions do not partake in the condensation, so only 4, 5, and 6 deform. And this results in light, photons. And now you can deduct the answer to the initial question about the number of angels on the needle tip. That's, of course, a metaphor for the superposition of light waves. There are two types of particles in particle physics, one being the fermions and the other the bosons. Two fermions cannot be at the same space, in the same state, they would collide. Bosons, to which photons belong, they don't care. Any number of them can overlap. They do not interact, or not necessarily. In Heim's model, this behavior finally becomes understandable because bosons have no spatial component. They cannot collide in space. If you start thinking about the consequences for the interpretation of quantum physics, that becomes very exciting. But that's stuff for yet another video. Now the riddle of the photons is solved, and only one case remains, that of only the structural coordinates 5 and 6 condense. This yields something that we must from now on consider a new component in physics. Heim called it activities. Activities have no mass, no charge. They don't oscillate. They are neither matter nor energy. They are, indeed, pure structural dynamics. You may have noticed that all other Hermitry forms have these structural coordinates involved, and therefore some component that is an activity. You may ask, why not consider a case where only space or only space-time deform? Well, remember the basic meaning of structure or of structural coordinate. If any physical event occurs, that means something happens that's distinguishable from empty space. If there were no something that has no structure, this would mean it is not distinguishable from empty space. But that's a direct contradiction to its existence. So anything that happens presupposes some kind of structure, QED. On the other hand, that means pure activities, that is, without space and time attached, can interact with any kind of matter, any kind of other of these Hermitry forms, and also amongst themselves, of course. It is difficult to imagine something that is not measurable. Being located beyond space and time, activities form the substrate for all these fascinating immaterial things we are talking about and are going to talk about. Activities are a physically real thing by which we can formally handle transcendent events and entities. There is a theory, or Heim had a theory, of how to artificially generate them, but that's technologically far out of range yet. However, they can explain a lot of phenomena we encounter in everyday life, in parapsychology, and also in the study of the UFO phenomenon. In general, activities have the property of changing probabilities within matter. That means they can cause material structures to form and to evolve. If pure activities intersect with ordinary space-time, they appear as gravitons. The strength of these effects is only dependent on the height of the organizational coordinate or organizational entity which is behind that. If you still have doubts at this point, from these considerations I introduced here only very briefly, Heim succeeded to deduct the masses of the elementary particles based on pure geometrical considerations. Even if this seems like a bold statement to you, that is something that no one else can yet claim to have achieved, so his approach should at least be seriously considered. In 1980, Heim had his mass formula programmed at the DESY synchrotron facility in Hamburg, Germany, where it showed that it could correctly predict the basic states of most elementary particles with very low error margins. I'm afraid you won't find any publications of the scientists involved there because they only used the formula. They did not dive into the theory and reviewed it. The DESY spokeswoman at that time stated that even a very good theoretician would have to work on Heim's theory at least for 1 year exclusively on Heim's theory to make a thorough and just judgment about it. If you are one such theoretician, or know one, or have the fundings to pay one for a year, you're welcome to make a start. A smaller start you can make by liking my video, subscribe to my channel. You may even want to consider to support my work on Patreon. Explaining and understanding Heim's theory is still a lot of work, but I think at the end it is worth it. At the end, we will see a new world in six dimensions and in color.